This time on the Highland Woodworker, how safe is your workshop?
It could arc and set something like that fine dust on fire.
See what happens when we invite a fire inspector inside my place. Some great advice for every woodworker to keep in mind.
Now, I just nibble off the waste here at the edges.
Fine Woodworking Magazine's Matt Kenney teaches us how to cut through dovetails using a table saw and a standard rip blade.
I built nuclear power plants, and this is just furniture.
Well, it's not just any furniture. Award-winning cabinet maker Ronnie Young gives us a tour of some of his amazing period pieces on our Moment with a Master, now presented by our friends at Woodpeckers. These stories and more, this time on the Highland Woodworker. Hello, I'm Charles Brock, and I'm a Highland Woodworker. I just love coming to Highland Woodworking in Atlanta, Georgia. They've got all the tools and the education that a woodworker needs. Ed Sint.
Chuck, good to see you again.
So nice to see you. Been doing well?
I'm doing okay, yeah, doing darn good.
Well, Ed, I've got a little problem with my table saw fence. It seems to need some adjustment. Have you got something that could help me?
I think so. It's maybe burning a little bit.
Yes, just a little.
We have a great tool by Woodpeckers called the saw gauge. It should help you check the dimension between the fence and the blade, both the front of the blade and the back of the blade, to hopefully get your squared up.
That sounds great. But first, Ed, how safe is your workshop?
I haven't thought about that too much.
Recently, a fire inspector came by my shop, and the results were very interesting.
Look forward to hearing about it.
Well, let's see. Wayne Mobley, so nice to see you.
Chuck, it's good to see you. Good to be here.
Well, yeah, this is my shop in Spring Hill, Tennessee, and I don't think you've ever been here before.
I haven't.
Well,
this is a first.
Yeah, this is a first, and you've been a lifelong woodworker. And so you know about woodworking.
Right. I love the shaker furniture, the simplicity of it, and that's what I concentrate on.
Yeah, and along with that, you are one of the fire inspectors for the city of Franklin, Tennessee.
That's correct. I've worked for the city for 20 years, and I have been a inspector for them 10.
So you are well qualified as a woodworker and a fire inspector to help me look at my shop and to try to find those things that will make a shop safer and especially fire safe.
That's correct, and that's why I'm here today, to help you.
Well, I don't think we're gonna find any problems here because my shop is somewhere probably close to perfect.
Well, you know I hear that a lot, Chuck.
well, I try. Let's go take a look.
All right, well, let me grab my pad and pen here, and that way I can write down a few things.
All right.
While we're walking, one of the things I look at is trip hazards. Cord is a trip hazard. What I suggest for you to do on cords is take a pad or something, lay it over it.
Like one of those rubber mats?
Like one of the rubber mats. Lay it over it, that way that's a walk area for you, and they won't grab it with their toe and trip.
Sure.
It's important to have egress. I make certain that there's a clear path to the exits, front and back if you have one. And another thing that we're gonna look at, is to make certain that you have extinguishers, and that their end date, this was inspected March of 2015, so it's due March of 2016. It is charged, and it is hanging. Now, you know, you were talking about, you didn't think I'd find anything here. Your housekeeping, this is great for a wood shop, but you could spend a little bit more time dusting. Come on, Chuck.
Well, okay. All right. Well, I understand. Thank goodness there are no big snares of cords like that.
And that's another thing. You know, when you get through with something, pick it up, put it away, and that way you have a clear path. You can get tangled up in this also. So this is another trip hazard. Also, you see this fine dust that's building up on your tools?
Sure.
That's the stuff that if it was to get airborne in the right condition, static electricity could set it off, and you could have a dust explosion, and or it could catch on fire. I also see, Chuck, that you have your air filtration along with your dust collection to help keep your dust down, but come on, Chuck, do you think you could clean up, take it out and clean it just a little
bit? Oh, man, that's bad.
Yeah.
Even the filter inside is just
jammed full. Yeah, well, just
see that? That's awful.
So.
Well, I've got to do better than that. That's dangerous. If the motor gets clogged up with dust, then it could be a fire.
And if it got hot enough, it could smolder and then catch on fire. Speaking of smoldering fires, on your table saw, how sharp is your blade? Do you clean the blade and get the pitch off of it often?
That's important because that pitch makes friction, doesn't it?
Correct. It makes friction. And whenever you're cutting, a lot of times, you don't realize how hot the dust gets. And it may get hot enough that it turns into embers, gets in your cabinet saw, and sits there and smolders. It may be the last thing you do that afternoon. And as you're walking out the door, you don't notice that there's smoke coming from the cabinet.
Or even like, I guess, pitch on router bits.
Yes.
Same thing. And mm-hmm. You're kind of, many times it's hard to capture those, and they're kind of thrown around the shop.
Right.
Or even, I know, drilling and especially in grain with the drill press.
It gets hot. You know that friction creates that heat. Chuck, what kind of finishes do you use?
I use an oil and wax finish. And I've got some over here. I just rub it on. It's a kind of a hand rub finish. But I start out with an oil first.
Okay. And how do you dispose of your rags?
After I finish rubbing it in, then I just take it over to a barrel or a rack or something where kind of air can get to it.
Well, that's
and let it dry.
That's good. That's good. I would suggest that if it's a nice day, I'd take the trash can and maybe take it outside and let it dry outside. That way you're doing it outside where it's not inside, just in case something did happen. Mm-hmm. The one thing that you have to be careful of is making certain that you spread that out, not wad it up or knot it up, because the dryer's in there is what makes the heat and accelerates and causes the fire.
So the dryers in the oil,
mm-hmm.
they continue to kind of work. And mm-hmm. if they're pushed together with the fibers of the rag,
right.
there's a place for them to kind of smolder.
To overheat.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
And cause the fire.
Well, I'm proud of this. Let me show you my bin over here where I keep most of my finishing materials. You'll probably like this. Of course, we always have too many things stacked on top of it.
Chuck, can I ask you, is that a UL listed cabinet for storing your?
Is it supposed to be UL listed?
It would be better if it's a UL listed. That's what we suggest, that it be a fire flame proof cabinet, UL listed.
Well, I mean,
and
look at the kind of
things. I don't think Rubbermaid has that.
Is that right? Well, look at the kind of things I have in here. I mean, I have paint thinner, I have shellac with alcohol. I have some polyurethane. I have a little bit of.
Can you smell the smell coming off that?
Yeah, it is. I mean, it kind of just wafts up. I have some lacquer thinner and waxes and things like that. So this isn't going to do.
No, I would suggest getting a UL listed cabinet.
Most woodworkers have to make up a cord and a plug for the receptacle they have.
Right.
And I did that years ago, and it's been sitting like that, and that's a hazard.
Right. And Chuck, here is a prime example. It was probably done right originally. You probably had this fitting tight.
It looks like it's pulled loose.
You can see where it's pulled out, and this is not good. Over time of you moving
the joiner
or just walking past, this could fray. And then this is 220. And all it takes is it to arc, and it could arc and set something like that fine dust on fire. Again, you could have a pile of dust over here that you haven't gotten to that day to clean up, and it can catch on fire. We need to make certain that our extension cords are pushed together good and tight, because what happens is whenever that cord is not together good, and you're walking through here and you bump it, it could arc, and it could be in a pile of sawdust where you've worked that day. And when it arced, it would start a smoldering fire.
Wayne, this always concerns me when I am at the grinder, because I see sparks, and I've got a little coverage of dust everywhere.
Mm-hmm.
And so should I be concerned about it?
Yes, Chuck, but you know what I'm happy with is that you recognize that you've got a hazard now. We've walked around, we've spent a little time walking around your shop, and you've recognized that.
So a blind squirrel can find a nut.
That's correct.
All right, good.
And you're right. You're standing there, you've got a whole set of tools, you're working on your chisels, you're working on your bench planes, and you're there for a while. You've got dust back behind it that you haven't got to clean, and you've produced these sparks. They fell into the dust. You've got a smoldering fire. Yes, it is a fire hazard.
Wayne, this is kind of a warehouse area and a work area for me. You see anything back here?
Well, I noticed that you are using surge protection back here. That's good. One of the things that I make a quick suggestion is don't block your electric panel. Leave 36 inches clear in front of the electric panel so you can open it up.
So you ought to be able to open the
Correct.
Door at least.
Correct.
Yeah, and now you can't.
This is in the way, so we're going to move it. Your other extinguisher is back here. That's good. As I'm looking in here, there's no open blanks. When I look in an electric panel, I make sure none of these are out. And if they are, they have little
a filler
in the place of it. The one thing that I do notice is you do need to get an electrician in here. It looks like there's been some breakers added and come up with a new list here.
Yeah, it needs to be updated.
Updated, yes.
Panel board update.
Yes, that way you know what you're cutting on and cutting off.
Yeah, because I've had to come back here and kind of search and end up going through all of them.
Right.
And if you have a condition that's raging out there,
right.
You hadn't got time to do that.
Right.
Well, Wayne, I've gotten a lot out of this. I thought my shop was near perfect, but you found some things, a lot of things.
I did, and you know, it's sort of like when I do my inspections, my commercial inspections, people don't see it, and all they need is someone that does my job to come in and kind of just remind them that these are hazards and kind of keep a mindful eye and watch for and correct them. My job, I feel like 90% of it's just educating people on life safety and fire safety.
And to prevent. Well,
mm-hmm.
Even though you found some things, I am so glad that we did this. And I think every wood shop needs to be evaluated every once in a while.
Yeah, and for wood shops, yours is fairly clean, but you do need to work on it just a little.
I'll try. Thank you so much, my friend.
Thank you for inviting me.
Over here is a display case for the Woodpeckers product line. And this was the saw gauge I was telling you about earlier. It's machined from aircraft grade aluminum. It's got a dowel caliper on it and a very unique system that'll allow you to reference the tool from your miter guide slot on your table saw.
Can you show me how it works?
Sure, I'll be happy to.
All right, so later on in the show, we'll go to the shop and see how it performs. Coming up, we'll show you how Fine Woodworking Magazine's Matt Kenney uses a table saw for those tricky through dovetails.
This little inlay piece here is called a paterae.
See how period furniture maker Ronnie Young uses hot sand to create three-dimensional shapes. Stay tuned. You're watching The Highland Woodworker.
I'm just an average, down-to-earth woodworker. On a scale of 1 to 10, I'm probably about a 5. But one place I score a perfect 10 is right here. And I plan on keeping all 10. That's why I have a saw stop table saw. And there's more. Plenty of power, superior dust collection, and absolute accuracy. These features have made it the best-selling cabinet saw in America. Let Highland Woodworking help you put a saw stop in your shop.
Order a saw stop professional cabinet saw in March or April of 2016 and choose either one of these accessories for free. That's a $199 extra value. Put a saw stop in your shop.
For 35 years, Lee has manufactured the world's best joinery jigs. From our award-winning dovetail jigs and mortise and tenon jigs, to newer innovations like router table jigs. Easily add strong, beautiful joinery to your woodworking pieces, like half-blind dovetails, box joints, mortise and tenon joints, and through dovetails. Lee, simply the easiest and most versatile router joinery jigs.
Introducing the ultimate flush trim router bit by Whiteside. Get CNC quality cuts from your patterns every time. Whiteside, industrial grade and American made.
Woodpeckers, makers of fine woodworking tools like router tables, precision router lifts and fences, plus measuring and layout tools including squares, rules, triangles and more. We offer unique clamps like box clamps, the knuckle clamp and X-mat system. Our one-time tool program offers woodworkers innovative new tools. Woodpeckers precision tools are made and tested using state-of-the-art equipment. Woodworking tools from Woodpeckers. Tools you can trust for generations to come.
Forest, manufacturer of the award-winning Woodworker 2, presents the PVW Blade, designed specifically for the rip and cross-cutting of plywood and plywood veneers without splintering or chip-outs. Highland Woodworking has been a leader in woodworking education for more than 30 years. They offer all kinds of woodworking classes year-round, ranging from how to hand-cut dovetails and mortises to how to sharpen a plane or a chisel, how to build a cabinet, a chair, or a bookcase, or how to turn a wooden bowl. There are classes on wood finishing, French polishing, and even antique furniture restoration. For a list of upcoming classes that may interest you, just look in their catalog or go to highlandwoodworking.com. Woodworking's Matt Kenney is going to give us the finer points of cutting dovetails on a table saw. Let's take a look.
There's no doubt about it. It takes a lot of skill and practice to cut dovetails by hand. Sure, you could cut them with a router and a jig, but they wouldn't have that hallmark hand-cut look. Wide tails, narrow pins. So to make machine-cut dovetails with a hand-sawn look, furniture maker Greg Paolini turns to the table saw. For this technique, you can use the miter gauge that came with your saw. You also need two fences, one for the tails and one for the pins. The fence has a tall back that supports the workpiece during the cut. The low, short base, well, a kerf gets cut into that, and you can align the layout lines on your workpiece with the kerf and end up with perfectly placed and accurate cuts. For the blade, I'm using a rip blade. It's got a flat bottom cut. And that means that on the pins, there won't be any paring to do. However, on the tails, there will be a little bit. Let's get started there. Start by scribing your shoulder lines on all your work pieces. Be sure to wrap this scribe line around the edges of your tailboards. Next, use a bevel gauge to lay out your joinery symmetrically around the board's center line. With your bevel gauge still set to the angle used for layout, set the angle of your table saw blade. Be sure the bevel gauge is touching the saw plate and not the carbide teeth. After cutting a kerf, align the board for the first tail cut. Clamp your stop lock in place and use this cut to adjust the blade's height to the baseline. Next, flip the board side for side and make the second cut. Rotate end for end and repeat the process on the opposite end of the board before moving on to the second tailboard. Now, you can reposition the stop block for the next cut. Rinse and repeat. Now, I just nibble off the waste here at the edges. There's just a little bit of waste to clean up in those sockets. It's pretty quick work with a chisel and a mallet. If you want to avoid this pairing, you can buy a table saw blade that's specially ground to match the slope of your dovetails. It gets right up in the corners and really leaves nothing left to do. Now mark your tailboard as you would normally. But remember to wrap your lines onto the face grain. You won't be able to see the marks on the end grain when you're cutting the joinery at the table saw. Now remember, because we're using stop blocks on our fences, we only have to mark one end of one pin board. Let's head back to the table saw and start cutting our pins. Use your bevel gauge to set the angle of the miter gauge. The bevel gauge is still set to the same angle used to lay out the tails and to angle the blade to cut them. Notice that I've also switched to my second fence. That's because you don't want the kerf used to cut the tails to interfere with the kerf used for cutting the pins. Now let's kerf this fence and get cutting pins. Now line up for the first cut and make sure you're cutting just shy of the pencil line. Clamp a stop block in place and make your first cut. Rotate the board 180 degrees and make the same cut on the other end of the board. Repeat this process for your opposite drawer side. Now reset your stop block for the next cut and continue on down the line. You'll notice that I didn't flip the board face for face as I was making these cuts. Don't want to do that. Make all the cuts in one direction first, and then change your miter gauge to the opposite angle and make the rest of them. After resetting the miter gauge, it's just a matter of repeating the process. I make my kerf cut, I line up my workpiece, clamp on a stop block, and make the remaining cuts. You can get rid of most of this waste with the fence set in this position. The little bit that can't, just swing it back to the opposite angle and take care of it that way. That's a nice looking joint. You know what? You can use the same technique to make half-blind dovetails for your drawer fronts. All you got to do, which is just what Greg Paolini does, is glue on a little veneer on the front.
I felt humbled by it, I can tell you that.
Period furniture maker Ronnie Young on winning one of woodworking's top achievements. That's next. You're watching The Highland Woodworker. We'll be right back. Highland Woodworking stocks a wide selection of Rycon power tools, known for their innovative design and rugged durability. Highland has sold thousands of Rycon's industry-leading bandsaws with sizes to fit every woodworking need, from the compact, affordable 10-inch model to competitively priced 14 and 18-inch models. Shop us also for Rycon's reliable planers, lathes, and professional low-speed grinder, all with an exceptional 5-year warranty. Rycon. Power tools. Are your tools Tormek sharp? Tormek, consistent, reliable, and razor sharp. Tormek, sharpening innovation.
If you can't make it to Highland Woodworking in Atlanta, Georgia, you can shop online at highlandwoodworking.com. They're great at getting what you want to your shop quick.
Moment with a Master is brought to you by Woodpeckers.
Ronnie Young has not only designed and built nuclear power plants, he builds powerful furniture pieces. In fact, the Society of American Period Furniture Makers recently awarded Ronnie its prestigious Cartouche Award. In our Moment with a Master, we'll see his outstanding work and hear his story.
Tucked beneath the rolling hills of Chattanooga, Tennessee, there sits a time portal of sorts. It's Ronnie Young's private workshop. From his classic hand tools to the blueprints of furniture design stacked on his project table, this place has everything a period furniture maker needs to create masterpieces like these.
People have asked me in the past, how do you know how to do all this? And I said, well, I was an engineer. I built nuclear power plants. I said, this is just furniture.
Well, Ronnie, thank you so much for having us here in your workshop. It speaks volumes. You have to be good at so many things to turn out the beautiful work that you do. Is the shop complete?
Pretty much. It's taken me a long time, but it's pretty much complete now. I don't desire another tool like I did for many years. I think I've finally collected an assortment of tools that lets me do the work that I need to do. And the way I got these tools, almost all of my tools are used. I have only a couple of new items. For years, I bought and sold used woodworking equipment, and I would fix it up, and if it was better than what I had, I would keep it, and I would sell the other piece. And over the years, I've been able to assemble a group of tools that I'm comfortable with. So both hand tools and power tools.
Well, and it looks like, I mean, to do period furniture, you have to be very good at a lot of skills and things.
That is true. You have to know not only a bit efficient use of power tools to size your wood that you're going to use, but then the details are almost always done by hand. And to be able to do that work, you need a good collection of hand tools, planes, scrapers, molding planes, that sort of thing. And I have a good collection now. It's taken a while, but I now have a set.
How did you know that the wood shop was for you when you were a little kid?
The first thing I remember about a wood shop, my grandfather had a little machine shop in Columbia, Tennessee, where I'm from, down by the depot. And across in his shop, the shop was divided into two sections. He was on one side, and there was a cabinet maker on the other side, a Mr. Matheny. Mr. Matheny was an old-time cabinet maker, and what he did was, if you didn't get the cannonball bed that your grandmother had when they divided the furniture up from the family, he would make you one, just like it. If you saw a piece of furniture in someone's home that you liked, Mr. Matheny would make it. So my earliest memory of a cabinet shop was walking out of my grandfather's shop next door into Mr. Matheny's shop, where he had a single bare light bulb hanging from the ceiling, and it smelled of shellac, hide glue, and sawdust. And I remember that.
A great mixture.
Yeah, yeah. And I remember that. And I guess that was my first exposure to someone doing woodworking. And somehow it stuck with me.
So this is your first
woodworking project?
The very first thing I ever made, made out of a 2x6 poplar board that the Cub Scouts made these for their fathers when I was 8 years old. We went down to Richardson Lumber Company in Columbia, Tennessee, and Mr. Richardson himself cut us off each a piece of poplar. We took it back and we hollowed it out so it would hold the glass ashtray and gave them to our fathers.
Heard you talk about builder and artist.
Yes.
Now, looking at your work, I would say that you're a marvelous artist, but you don't see it that way.
No, I'm more of a copier than an artist. I think an artist is someone who can sit down with a blank piece of paper and come up with a design. My method is to look at really good designs and try to reproduce them. And a lot of times my designs or the things I make are not an exact copy of a single thing, but components of several different pieces that I think go well together.
Ronnie, I recognize that as a beautiful Newport-style chest of drawers. Tell me about it.
Yes, it is a Newport-style chest of drawers, and I made my reproduction in cherry rather than mahogany like it would have originally been made. I like cherry a lot. It looks better with age, and this reproduction is made of cherry. You'll notice that the front of this drawer has shell carved on it. That shell is carved in the solid, not applied. So often today on reproductions, this would have been an applied piece, but I carved it in the solid. So this drawer front started out 2.5 inches thick.
And that allows for the grain to flow all the way through that drawer
front. I'm glad you noticed that. That is exactly right. The grain follows across perfectly. So it makes for an overall better look of the furniture.
Well, I understand this is one of your favorites.
It is one of my very favorite pieces that I've made. It's an American sideboard in the Sheridan style. It's not an exact copy of any particular one I saw, but more of a combination of several different ones that I researched when I was getting ready to make this. It's made of walnut and walnut veneer. The unique thing about these sideboards is that they are curved. You'll notice that they're convex on the sides, concave in the center. And this was the style that was very popular during Sheridan's period. The drawer fronts and all the curved surfaces, the doors, are all, I made them with laminations. This is 1/8 inch walnut laminations glued and bent over a form to reproduce this curve. The originals would most likely have been made out of a solid piece of a secondary wood and then veneered, but I used the lamination method. It also has cock beading around all the drawers, you'll notice. The cock beading is there not only for a decorative element, but also to protect the veneer so it does not get chipped off at the sides from wear. I make that cock beading with a scratch stock. It's very thin and delicate, and machine tools just are not the thing to do it with.
They would just tear it up.
They would tear it up, so I do scrape those. Now, there were lots of combinations that they used for drawers and doors. This particular one, I had a door on this side, and a drawer on this side. They look the same, but one's a drawer and one's a door. Also, you'll notice the keyholes, the keyhole liners, nice white-looking keyhole liners. Those are ivory, made from old piano keys.
Ronnie, I've never seen a more beautiful chest on chest. This is gorgeous, from the fretwork all the way down.
I like this chest very much. I saw it for the first time, the original, at the Colonial Williamsburg Museum up on the second floor. They have the original of this chest. It was made originally in Charleston, South Carolina by a cabinet maker named Thomas Elf. The outstanding thing about this chest, of course, is the fretwork along the top. The lazy eight fretwork there just under the cove molding at the top is a Thomas Elf example of something that he would have put on his chest. This chest is mahogany. I was lucky enough to get some really nice mahogany veneer that matches all the way down from the top drawer all the way to the bottom. This veneer is old veneer. So the veneer you get today is so thin, it's difficult to work with. This veneer was probably cut in the 60s.
What's the thickness?
It's about, I would guess, somewhere a little under a 32nd. It also has some features in it that are a little different. It has a butler's drawer. Drawer pulls out and turns into a desk. This piece of furniture would have sat in the front hall of a fine home in Charleston and would have been the place where the butler or matron of the house kept all her information. These little cubby holes and drawers would have kept different things that they needed to run the house, letters as they were received, bills, that sort of thing. And then when you are not using it as a desk, you can close it up and it slides right back in place.
Just days prior to recording this interview, Ronnie Young was awarded the Society of American Period Furniture Makers' prestigious Cartouche Award. This award is presented annually to one deserving candidate who has inspired, instructed, and impacted the world with their woodworking skill set.
I felt humbled by it, I can tell you that, because when I looked at the other folks that had won that award in the past, it was pretty humbling because they're some of the best cabinet makers there is.
Ronnie, I've seen this kind of work on most of your pieces.
Right.
Is there a fancy name for this?
Yes, this little inlaid piece here is called a paterae. I think that's a French term, I'm not positive, but it's a figure. This one happens to be of a shell. That was a popular motif that was used in England and in this country for our decorative elements on furniture. You also see eagles, American eagles, on federal furniture, period, say 1800 to 1815, you see a lot of eagles. I like making them. They're something not everybody does, and so I enjoy making them. This is a fan inlay. You can see it looks three-dimensional.
And that's the object.
And the reason it does is because of the shading in the corners. Now, how do you do that? Well, first off, we're going to lay out a fan, and we want it to be about this big. So this is my cutting board for cutting the veneers with, or cutting little pieces with. Lay that out. Then we want four elements, so we divide the arc into four individual pieces, strike a line through there, and then we start with veneer. This is a piece of maple veneer, and we're going to put it in sand. Now, let me tell you a little about this sand. This is important. The sand needs to be very fine. You do not want to use builder sand. It's too coarse. And the reason you don't want to use builder sand is you have voids between the grains of sand that don't heat evenly. You want very, very fine sand. And where I get this sand is at the pet store. This is iguana sand. And it's run through a sieve, and it's very, as you can see, very, very fine, powdery almost. If you can't go to the Gulf Shores area and get some of the sand off the beach down there, this is the next best thing.
Well, that's wonderful to know. I would have headed right for the big box.
No, you don't do that. You'll be disappointed. Okay. This makes a much more even char, and that's what it is, a char. You're charring the wood. You'll notice, first off, that I'm not cutting these little diamond inlays first. If you do that, you'll burn the corner off. So you take a solid piece, and the further you go down in the sand, the hotter it's going to get because it's getting close to the cast iron bottom. You only put enough sand in there for the distance that you need to char. You put it down in there and you wait a few seconds. You can count to yourself. Pull it out. It's beginning to char, you see? Not quite enough. We want it to be a little darker than that. Okay, we'll try it again. That's looking right there, see? Then we'll do the other edge. And then you can see the three-dimensional effect. Push the sand up around it.
And depth makes a big difference.
It does. Yeah. Looks pretty good.
Just outstanding.
That's all you have to do. Now, we want to start our cutout. And we want, on this one, we're going to make it just like that one, so we want the shaded edge to the center. So we line the piece up along there. And I use a plane blade. Really works good.
Because it's wide
and
straight.
It's wide and straight. Put it on the line. That, hold it in place. It needs to come over just a little bit. And there's our first piece. Now we're going to make the second. And these, if we've done this right, these are all supposed to be exactly the same size, right? So we'll put the shaded area against the line again. Come in here with our blade, line it up. There's our second piece. Now, we need to hold these down while we put them together. if you lay them down like this without the having something to hold them, I'm not going to stay there. I have a secret. Let me get it. You can get this at Walmart. It's Avery printer paper. It's for making stick-on labels. It comes like this. It's got a stick-on, a peel-off back. Now this is sticky. Place that down. That holds it. It's not going to move. Next one in place right next to it. Push it up tight at the bottom. There's the second one. Now we'll char another couple. I use this for all of the paterae and things I make. I use that sticky paper to hold them in place.
That makes great sense.
It's better, it works better than packing paper. It looks pretty good. Try that.
Looks good.
It's pretty good. Go back. We always wanted the charred edge on the outside, right? You can put them. You can make mistakes. You can char the wrong side. If you do that, you have to start over. Line up everything. Get it right on the line. There's another one. And one more. Charred edge on the outside. There. If you get your hands on the sticky paper, your hands will stick to it as well. We want the charred on the outside, not the inside. Here we go. And if we've done this right, that should be a 90 degree corner there, right?
Sure.
If it's not, we can always do a tiny adjustment with the block plane. There. Now the next step we want to do is we want to draw an arc to make the ellipses there on the end. Go back to our center, make a mark. Now we can go to our tools and select a gouge. It's got a curvature that'll fit between those marks. Like right there. The next one, fit it between the two points where they cross. Go to the next one, the two points where they cross. And the last one. And there we have another quarter fan.
What would you like to be remembered by as a cabinet maker?
I would like to be remembered as someone who built furniture that was typical of what we found in our part of the country in Middle Tennessee. Furniture that was built, say, from 1790 to 1840. Those pieces of furniture that people from our part of the country have a connection with. They saw that same piece of furniture in their grandmother's house or their great-grandmother's home. They may even own a piece of furniture that belonged to one of their relatives. If they don't have one, I'll be glad to make them one. So that's the kind of thing I like.
You also mentioned that you like to pass on
passing on, yes,
tools and
not only the tools, but also the interest in making this kind of furniture. I received some tools from a friend that they belonged to his father. He kept them at home for a number of years, and he knew I was interested in woodworking. He passed them on to me. They're very nice tools, hand tools, carving chisels. He told me that he was passing them on to me at no charge, giving them to me. And the agreement that I made with him was that when I was finished with them someday, I would pass them on to another cabinet maker who was interested in preserving the techniques that we use. And I intend to do that.
Well, you know, Ed, the problem has always been that the miter gauge had to mount in the slot and then slide along with some rigidity, but in, you know, a very firm way. How does this solve that problem?
Yeah, Woodpeckers came up with a unique system that allows this actual machine bar steel with these two smaller diameter ones that drop into the slot, and then this traverses those two and it centers itself on the slot.
Well, that's brilliant.
Then it gives you a little bit of variability where you can drop down on top of that. And then it's situated. This is going to ride perfectly centered in the slot as you go fore and aft. And it'll then let the dowel indicator give you your readout. So we're about 2/1000ths there from the front of the blade to the back of the blade, which is acceptable, but you can tweak your fence adjustment to get it even closer if you wanted to.
Well, that's a brilliant design. And that'll even help you out at the end. Just skew it ever so slightly so that you won't burn your stock.
Yep. And you won't have that pinch. So a little bit open is what a lot of people prefer versus trying to have it be exactly the same, just a little bit greater at the outfeed side.
Well, again, Woodpeckers, a brilliant design.
It makes them a great product.
Improve your woodworking experience. Sign up for Wood News Online, a monthly newsletter showcasing the latest news, tips, and classes Highland Woodworking has to offer. By signing up, you'll receive the latest episode of The Highland Woodworker, special store promotions, and Wood News Online delivered straight to your inbox. Sign up today.
Well, that's all the time we have for this episode. Follow us on our social media channels as well. And until next time, I'm Charles Brock, and I'm a Highland Woodworker.